Good afternoon, and thank you for staying. I'm very honored to be here as the last speaker, I guess, that has a lot of confidence in my talk. So after this long day that you will stay awake, and I will guide you through the next, say, half hour, three quarters of an hour, and then this first day of this impressive conference is over. Let me introduce myself first. I'm Jolijn Kruijtsberg. I already said it's a very difficult name to pronounce, even in the Netherlands. So, I grew up in Holland. I studied in Groningen, where I am now living, and I started studying psychology there, and switched halfway towards business administration, which people found a very strange shift. But I always say, well, if you don't want to do one thing, you have to do really something else to inspire yourself. But on the whole, both studies weren't really what I expected it to be. But now, being a social entrepreneur, I think something comes together that already has been in me for decades, but I had to learn to find out. Van Hulley is basically, it started 4 years ago, 4.5 years ago. And it's funny that we started with a very old company. I think it started in 1870 or something. And then Klaus came with a 14-year-old company. So for the starters among you, I am the youngest company. I'm not the youngest person, but I'm the youngest company, youngest social enterprise here. So, and I learned quite a lot in the last 4.5 years, and hope to get you with some tips and tricks for how to survive as a social enterprise. I'm still learning, though. What do we do with Van Hulley? Van Hulley is basically is a workshop where you send in your shirt and you get it back as a boxer short. It's a web shop, and you send in your own shirt, you get it back as a boxer short. So the fabric from the shirts is basically good enough for the most part. And I had this idea a long time ago already. It's about 30 years ago, I think, that my husband had a shirt that we bought in the United States. He didn't want to throw it away, but he couldn't wear it anymore. It was just, you know, he wore it so many times, and we basically had to throw it away. And I'm a person who is, you know, doesn't want to throw things away, so we kept it. He wears these wide boxer shorts, so I thought, well, why don't we try to make something out of this? So I did that, and it stayed in my mind for almost 30 years. And I have been an entrepreneur already before I started Van Hulley. I was already 20 years on my own, had my own company, doing quite different things from what I do now. But also, I have always been thinking of new ideas. And this idea stuck to my mind, but I thought, well, making a boxer short out of your own shirt, that means doing the production locally. That's a lot of things to do, you know. I had my agency with my laptop very, you know, on my own, in my own company, and I thought, well, do a production, that's maybe not my thing. But then there was a certain moment then when I had time on my hands. I was with a friend, and she said, well, don't you have any other nice ideas? I said, well, I have this idea. And she said, well, you should do it. Why just don't you try it? And then I started talking about my idea with several people, and that lasted for a year. And after that year, I sort of thought, well, I have to do this. And because I got the feeling that this time frame is really perfect for a company like Van Hulley, and it wasn't 30 years ago. So this was the moment that I had to grab it and that I had to start it. So I started the company on the 1st of November in 2012, after a year of practicing and having talks and having a lot of help, which you can hear from several other speakers as well, that once you have a good cause, I think it's not that that hard to find help. So I am now making boxer shorts, and I guess you are very interested in how they look. So I brought two with me. And this is where the hard part comes. We have two models. This is the male version. I'm going to hand it around so you can feel it and touch it, which makes you order it in the end, of course. there's some really nice details on the boxer short. For the man's, for instance, we use part of the sleeve as for your zipper. So we need a long sleeve shirt in order to make a real Van Hully out of it. And then after a year, we started this female product, which is not really underwear, but more sleepwear or beachwear. But it can be made from your own shirt. It can be made from a man's shirt, so for a Valentine's present or anything, you know. Or these misfits that hang in your closet. You know, we're a lot of women in the house, and you know, you're going to wear it next summer, but you don't. You can make it into a boxer short. So, shall I throw it to you? Good. We have all sizes. You don't have to fit it here. So that's Van Hully. And right from the start, we had a lot of publicity on Van Hully. Right when we started, we had it's been on the news. It's been in the newspapers. I've been wondering what was the success factor. And I think what I already said, it perfectly fits into the time frame of now, and it's built basically on three pillars. That's social, sustainable, and personal. I think all three different parts really have a link to what we in society now think as very important. Let's start by the last one, the personal one. Of course, it's a personal thing to send in your shirt and make it into a boxer short. We get really nice stories. In fact, when you order your shirt or your short from the web shop, we now ask you if there's a story behind the shirt that you send in, which is really nice for the women who make it to get this this idea of what shirt they make. But also, we do it the other way around as well, because when your shirt comes in, we send you an email and say, okay, it's done. And then again, when we send it out, we tell you that it's on its way to you. And then there's also a little card from the seamstresses that have checked it with a personal note. And I don't know whether you notice that there's more and more a need, at least in the Netherlands, but I think it's global, it's worldwide. There's a tension that people, a tendency that people, you know, they want to know the story behind the product. They, in this whole globalizational world, digitization, the one-on-one contact, the person that made your product, or at least knowing where it comes from, how it's produced, that's becoming more and more an issue. And I think that is why Van Hully really touches you. You buy something that is more than just a boxer short. You send in something personal, you get something personal back. And that works. About the stories, you know, this is obviously a boxer short that was a shirt that was painted by children. But we also have this as an example to gay guys who got married in these shirts and they wanted boxer shorts out of it. That was very nice. And we also get these sort of handwritten notes. What I didn't realize, for instance, was that several women send in shirts from their deceased husband and said, well, it feels like a sort of traitor if I throw them away, but can you make for my children boxer shorts? So these are very dear stories. But there's also an hilarious a case of a woman who sent in her shirt, her husband's shirt, and it had the stain of an ironing thing, you know, where you iron. And normally the seamstresses are very handy in, you know, cutting around it and, you know, avoiding the stains and the the torns. And now she said, could you please put that on the back? Because my husband wanted to iron, and then his phone went. And probably you remember this box thing. Man, only one box, and then the telephone goes, and you don't remember that you're ironing. And then, so the iron thing was on the back of his boxer short. Lots of fun in the workshop. We had social, sustainable, and personal. And the sustainable part was obvious for me, of course. Returning, recycling the fabric is obviously something sustainable. It wasn't always that high in my in my marketing strategy. In the clothing industry, there's, I think, 1,000 sort of certificates that you can get from being a sustainable clothing company. And I didn't want to go into that. But then I got this invitation from for an award, the Circular Awards, whether I wanted to subscribe because they thought I was a really innovative idea. I did that, and I had to find out how sustainable it was. And it turned out that the cotton for only one boxer short for making the fabric is already 560 liters of water. And that's a lot. That's really a lot. So in adding that all up for last year's award, that added up to millions of liters of water and pesticides and carbon dioxide that we managed to spare from the earth, which is impressive, I think. And it got me in the second prize of this award. And the funny thing is, it was an award at the World Economic Forum in Davos. And I ended up second after the copiers company, Canon. And I thought, yeah, I was walking in Davos. I thought, well, I'm only 3 years underway and now I'm walking here. So basically, there is also a tendency that this sort of recycling, upcycling is really, the sustainable part is getting more and more well known for consumers to decide on. And I don't know if this is the same in Latvia, but in Holland, like 20 years ago, if you would wear secondhand clothing, it was considered a sort of, you know, poor man's thing, sort of dusty, rusty, not really popular. Whereas now, if you find bloggers and vloggers, they're all, you know, it's vintage, it's called, which is much more high end, and you know, combined with a haute couture thing, you're really the boss in every party. So that's the second part. The sustainable part is becoming more and more something that people want to wear. But our most important pillar that Van Hulle is built on is the social part. And I told you when I started the company, I realized that I had to do this locally. I had to produce it locally. And I got in contact with an organization in Groningen. That's a multicultural organization, and they organize, you know, biking tours or pregnancy yoga, but also all for women who have sort of not a lot of social life. It's not exclusively for immigrant women, but it's also for Dutch women, but it's a multicultural organization. I called them because I already thought, well, this is something everybody can learn how to do. It's easy. We only have two models, six sizes. You know, it's not that difficult. So I called this organization, and they said, well, yes, we're going to help you, because there's a lot of women who would like to have some working experience, but they don't know how to do this, so we're going to help you. I started out with six women, and it, even in the first year, it already expanded to 12. And I used a sort of, the municipality of Groningen has this the sort of way on how to get these people getting work experience without taking their allowance away. So I had the opportunity to for them to give them 16 hours of working experience, whereas they still kept their allowance because they didn't have a job, and they get a little bit extra from the municipality, which was nice, which was really good. But after a year and a half, I saw in these women that they had other talents, and why should they be making boxer shorts for the rest of their lives? And I could see that the impact that I was making by giving them this working experience was so much more than learning them how to sew a boxer short, which is a very, you know, narrow business thing. So one was having a dream of being a journalist in the end, and another one wanted to go into the care, and another one wanted to start her own catering company. So after a year and a half, and I using this thing from the municipality, I thought, well, it's a bit thin. It's sort of, you know, it looks like I'm using these women as a sort of free of charge employees, and it didn't feel right. And then I decided that maybe schooling together with that would be a much better thing. So I went to a school that is called ROC in the Netherlands, which is a low level school. And I thought, well, maybe there is some sort of program that they can enter into, and then they can move on further in other educational programs. And so by the year of 2014 in September, well, before that in the summer, I said to all these 12 ladies, I said, well, I'm going to change the concept of Van Hully. I was, from the start, I was thinking, well, maybe you know, if all business goes well, I will get you a fixed job, but you can do so much more and you don't really want to be a seamstress, so why don't I help you with guiding you towards your next step? And why don't I get you an education together with your friends, your colleagues that you are together with now? It means that for the next year, from September to July, you would have to go to school for a day and a half, and you would have to make your 16 hours of working experience with Van Hully. And with that, I think that was the moment that I really turned into a social entrepreneur. And and with that, I also decided that every year I have a new group of women coming in, which I will return to later on, creates a problem of your operating core being absolute amateurs and starting all over again every year. But the schooling turned out to be a huge success. Our impact is really, really good. From those who get the diploma at the end, almost 90% takes a next step. So they're not back on the couch where they came from. They do either a next level education and make themselves worth more, or they start their own company, or they have a job. And these things are the things that matter. And what we do is we provide a sort of bridge between the couch and your next step, the couch and your job, future job. So the whole schooling program and also the working experience is very focused on how to get the talents out of these women that are there but need to get out because they've been, you know, they've been down there and they don't really know. So making the boxer shorts has become a bit less a center than the whole schooling thing. This is the diploma ceremony, and it's impressive to see, and it's, every year I can't stop crying at the ceremony, because at that moment you really see what an impact you have, and it's impressive to see, because how do I, every new group that enters in August or September, some women don't even, you know, look you in the eye. They are too shy. They've been, you know, they're damaged sometimes, really bad. And they all have their history. And then within a month or within 2 months, you can see that they, you know, they start to grow, they start to glow, they shine, they have a responsibility, which is so much different from, you know, doing a sort of day thing. They have a responsibility. That's why I'll have them signing your card if you get your boxer back. That's their responsibility. They have to think, okay, if I get my name in here, that's the way I say, okay, it's good enough. It's a real Van Hully. And also during the process, you notice that we as Dutch are very direct. But from other cultures, that's very different. People, some of these women find it very, very hard to say that they've done something wrong. And so we try to emphasize on that. It's a good thing. If you do something wrong and you admit it, that's a way to learn it. And in a very practical case, if you don't say it and nobody says it, you end up with a boxer short that has the zipper down down there or doesn't fit or anything. And they all know that we have real clients. They go out with me to do presentations like this, and they meet the clients, they talk to the clients, there are clients who visit our workshop, so it's serious business. And it doesn't, you know, it's the fact that they don't get paid is not an issue. It's serious for them, and it's their responsibility to make every Van Hully as good as they can. When I started this schooling thing, I also went to the municipality and said, I think we make a lot of impact here. I think we can do really big steps with this addition, but I can't do it on my own because I do have to sort of run the business in a commercial way as well. So now I get money for every participant from the municipality, and from that money I have hired somebody who guides these women, who is responsible for the intake, for the whole process during this year, but also for what happens after that year, because it would be too easy to say, okay, well, that's been a fantastic year, you've now been all empowered, and this is your talent, and, you know, bye, good luck with it. And so what we do is we really keep them close, because we're not an institution. We keep them close as a sort of community, and we try to meet them about 3 times a year at a breakfast on Saturday morning, because a lot of these women now go to school or they have a job, so they don't have time during the week. And we meet each other so we can exchange our experience. Everything clear until now? How am I on time? I'm good? Okay. I want to share with you the story of Birgul, who was there at the opening of Van Hully, started in this participation job that requires 16 hours of working experience. I had no schooling at that moment. She said, no, this is too much. She always came late, always came late. And Birgul said at a certain moment, no participation job for me. I'm going to be a volunteer for 2 mornings in a week, and that's enough for me. She had 3 young sons, and she came to Groningen, which is in the north of the Netherlands, because she had been kicked out literally from her house with her sons in somewhere in the south. So she had no social life, nothing, Turkish woman. And so Birgul, so, you know, these people, you have a sort of soft spot. She came late every morning. And then I had this idea of adding the schooling. And to my big surprise, Birgul said, yes, I want to do that too. I said, well, Birgul, it's fine with me, but, you know, you have to be on time. You have to do 16 hours with Van Hully, and you have to go to school a day and a half. No, but yes, I want to do this. And she did. And she's now in an education, because she wants to go, in the end, she wants to end up helping people that helped her when she was fleeing from her husband. And I think that was very impressive. And it says here the importance of measuring impact, and that's something that I want to discuss with you as well, because this is a big issue now in Holland. And it also comes to the thing with the grants. It was you, I think, you the financial question? Yes. Because what social entrepreneurs do is they attach a sort of problem in the society and they try to solve it. But how do you measure your success? With me, with Van Hully, some things are really easy to measure. For instance, if I find a job for one of these ladies, that would mean the allowance would be gone, and that would mean she would pay taxes on a governmental scale. So that would be income also, and that's very nice. That's very euro calculated, easy thing to do. But for Birgo, for instance, what? But also the other women. What influence, what is it worth if somebody has so much structure in her life again? If she has a bigger social social life, if she has colleagues, if she's counted upon? That's very, very, very difficult to measure. And in the Netherlands, and I think everywhere, but also everybody's struggling with a good method of measuring your social impact. And so there are methods, but it's not easy. But I know, I see every day that I make an impact, but it's very hard to measure. And I hope that the methods will be, that research through universities and high schools, that they're all becoming more, that knowledge will be shared throughout, you know, Europe on this issue, because it's very important that we at least try to prove what we are worth. And it doesn't really have to be in euros, but it has to be in a sort of worth that counts. Whoa. This is Birgul now. I'm not allowed to use this picture, but I think it's so funny because it tells it all. You know, she's self-confident, she's working her way through school, she gets really high grades. I started this measurement of social impact also by interviewing women, but also the children of these women. And I also interviewed one of the sons of Birgul on, you know, what has changed in your family situation. Would you like your mother to be back home again? And all the children I interviewed, they all said, no, she has to keep on doing this. It's good for her future, because especially with these immigrant women, the children speak the language so much better. And they all see the problem with their moms lacking behind in the language and all that. So it's very important that for the children, that the women move on, that the mothers move on. And these mothers have a big influence in the schools, in the neighborhoods, and now they also bring on the new ladies for next years, because all these friends in school, they see, hey, my friend is doing really well and she now has a job, or she's going to school, and that's what everybody wants. So that's Birgul, and her son, for instance, that's something I always mention in presentations. I asked her son, well, what has changed? It's your mum, she doesn't have so much time for cooking. And he said, well, yes, a lot has changed, but I want her to move on. And my mum is also very hurried in the morning, because she has to be on time. I said, well, yes, that's a big problem with your mum, but she now is on time. And he said, and I think he was 12 or 13, he said, when she's going to work or to school, to Van Hully, I now prepare her sandwiches for lunch. Now, I don't know if your children have ever prepared lunch for you, but my children have never prepared lunch for me when I was going to work. It was the other way around. But try to imagine the impact of this little boy who never really had a father, and is now making sandwiches because he wants his mother to succeed. I think that's impressive. I'd like to put this in euros, but it's not possible, but it's an effect. Now I want to take it a bit of a level higher. The lessons I learned through in the last 4 or 5 years. And the first is that is mentioned is marketing and communication, which is not really something that I personally learned, but it's something that has been mentioned before. I did business administration, and I have a really, I love marketing and communication, so I really like it. I'm, building a brand is something I really like. But I encounter a lot of social enterprises, entrepreneurs who do not really have a feeling for marketing and communication. And I think it's really essential that if you want to start a business or if you want to develop it into a social enterprise, do never underestimate the power of marketing and communication. And it starts, of course, with delivering a product or service that really is a good quality, because if my boxer shorts don't really fit well, you do it maybe once because you think it's a, you know, good charity cause, but I want you to want one every time you want to throw away a shirt, that you send it to me. So it has to be a perfectly good product, but you also have to market it really. So you have to understand your client. You have to grab the thing, the motivation, why he or she wants to buy it. And for me, it's a combination of wanting to do this, but also the sustainable part and the social part. But you really have to focus on understanding your client and communicating with him or her in the way that he or she will really be ordering your product or service. Marketing is also a thing that is underestimated into other stakeholders. For instance, I think I do a really good marketing job with the municipality. I convinced them to invest in Van Hulley because I have a really good story to tell. I believe in it, and I'm very convincing. If I want, if I want to get my message across, so the marketing is also in areas that is not, that are maybe not that natural for you to think of. It's more than just the client. You have to market your product or service in every detail on every occasion. The second is something that I really learned. Patience, which is also a very recognizable for a lot of entrepreneurs. We're all impatient. We always think that the thing we thought of is a super thing that everybody is waiting for. So I said to my husband, who is the cause of all this, I said, well, let's see where we are a year from now at the start. And then the year was over, and I had just started, so I had to go on. And I'm still, trying to become bigger and stronger and more profitable. But it takes a lot of patience, and things go always slower than you think. So that's a warning, and don't be, disillusioned by it. The third thing is something else. It says courage. And courage means from the start having the guts to talk about it, which I did also. Don't ever be afraid that it's being copied. You are the one with the idea, so you have to go out there. And if you don't let it go, it will never stream, so you will never have feedback. So it's no way that you can start something without talking it about it to other people. You have to be vulnerable and be able to be vulnerable in that sense. And that is something that I also encountered, that during this year of preparation, I had one meeting with a guy who said his first reaction to when I showed him this this sample model, he said, "Oh, I'm jealous." And he was the owner of a big recycling company that also had a workshop, and I thought, well, there goes my idea. And every time I mailed him, I thought, well, I'm going to keep him close, But every time I mailed him, he said, well, yes, well, you can think, you know, it's maybe not a very original idea. Everybody can come up with this. And I thought, well, that's strange. I don't trust him. But then I never heard from him again. I had this advantage. And my theory is also that the copiers of this world are never social entrepreneurs because they go for the big money. And if you want to go for the big money, you're not in this room, and you will never be a social entrepreneur because your profit will be not in euros. So courage is that. Courage is also, compared to money, something that a lot of students sometimes say to me, okay, well, I have this idea, but I need money. And I said, if your idea is okay, then there's also money. And that is also the effect that you don't need money, you need courage. Courage to go out and talk about your idea. Also, I said to you, I just had to start. I had so much help from friends and family. And when I started Van Hully, I didn't know it was that much work and it would cost that much money. I just started, which is not a very handy idea. But I also say to students, if I would have wanted to start the way I learned back then in my business administration studies, I would probably still be counting and scenario thinking and all these different things. And I started, which is maybe not wise. Maybe you should have a little bit of preparation more than I did. But it turned out to be, for me at least, I started, and then after a few months, I got this foundation, a mail from a foundation that is specialized in giving funds to starting social entrepreneurs. I didn't even know the expression social entrepreneur by then. But I got this mail and they said, well, we read in the newspaper that you started and we think it's very brave. And well, how did you start? And don't you need money? And then I thought, well, if a foundation is mailing me, like, you know, would you have some? And I was already, you know, towards the ceiling with, you know, it's so much work with the production and with the social media and all that, that yes, please. And it has been like that in the last 3-4 years, that every time I needed money, it wasn't that difficult to get it. It was just a question of having a real good plan, what to do with the money. So courage more than money. Talk about it. It's been said before. Talk about it with a lot of people and don't hesitate to ask for help, because if people believe in your company and that you're not there for the profit, they really want to join you. They want to have, you know, share their expertise with you. And that really is very helpful, to get things for free, like Camilla said this morning. So what are my challenges for the next years, and what is something I still struggle with? I told you about measuring social impact. I really hope at the end of this year, or at best at the beginning of a new group of women in September, I would be further with my measuring system. But it's very nice, very important, I think. And it's also something that would be helpful for getting money from the municipality. It's very handy for getting, for convincing others that you are a social enterprise, although you also think that profit is not a bad thing to do. So I think it's very good that we are now having two students trying to get a framework ready for measuring this social impact. And then there's also the long-term business model, because I'm very honored that I'm here, and I think that I'm, you know, everywhere that I'm on stage, I'm presented as a sort of successful social entrepreneur. And I think on the social part, I've been really successful, as I told you, but I'm not profitable yet. I have three sorts of income. Money-wise, it's the income from my revenues from selling the boxer shorts, of course, and the vouchers. It's also the money I get from the municipality, which is okay if I deliver a service that saves them money. If I can prove that by measuring my social impact, I think I have a good case and they would be stupid not to use me. If I can prove that, for instance, every euro that is invested in Van Hulley, I can get them 1.20 euro back, which is already with one woman in a fixed paid job is already the case, then they would be stupid not to use me as a delivering this service. But then the third part would be the grants that I still get and that I'm still relying on for covering part of my overhead costs. And that is very frustrating as an entrepreneur. So that is the first thing I would want to cut out. And I've already calculated that if I wanted to cut that out by only making the boxer shorts, more boxer shorts, then I'm encountering this problem that I told you before. My whole operating core is, you know, new in August or September. And although we are now really efficient in making a boxer short, it's a sort of friction between my social and my commercial goals. So what I'm now working on is a plan on getting investors, on introducing Van Hulley as a ready-made boxer shorts, but then from material that already exists, but not necessarily from your own shirt. So it's a sort of recycling fabric, and then you can order it online without sending in your shirt. So that's why what I'm aiming at, and you know, it keeps me busy, and I don't know whether I succeed, but it's a logical next step where I can still keep this educational workshop with 15 women every year that I empower and that I give a second chance, and I could copy that to other cities if I wanted to, but also a means to be more self-supporting. I'm getting towards the end of my speech. And this is from Anita Roddick. She's the founder of The Body Shop. And I find it really, really inspiring. Because people say to me, well, you know, what are you really contributing? And this is what I believe in. If you never start, you never know. And this really keeps me going, and I think it's a very funny one. And I like to be that mosquito because I set an example in a time that is really ready to be more social than just going for the money. So I would like you to remember that it should never be a reason not to start. Even if you're so small, it can be very big, and I hope to be back in 10 years, and then you would say, okay, well, now she's big. Now she's the boxer short worldwide Van Hulley brand. Let me end by saying that being a social entrepreneur is really, really the best thing that ever happened to me. It takes out absolutely my talents in every way. It's so diverse, it's so rewarding, and I told Madara, I don't know how to spell your name, but it's that I've never worked that hard, and I've never earned money. I've earned more money before, but I've never been happier. It gives me so much energy, and I think that is something that I would wish you all to experience, doing something that really gets the best out of you. And for me, the social and the entrepreneurial side is really a great combination because it challenges you to be commercial, to think of a market. And at the same time, every time, every day I look at these faces of these beautiful women that I'm able to help with such a basic, simple idea of a boxer short. Thank you very much.
Liels paldies par šo stāstu, un tiešām ir fantastiski dzirdēt stāstu no pašas idejas, kad vispār ideja tikai ir dzimusi, un dzirdēt to visu ceļu, kā Jolaine un viņas kolēģi ir nonākuši līdz tam, kur viņi ir šobrīd. Vismaz man tas bija ļoti, ļoti iedvesmojoši. Un tagad kārta jūsu jautājumiem, ja jums ir jautājumi, jūs kaut ko vēl gribat papildus noskaidrot vai pajautāt, tad šis ir tas brīdis. Vai zāle ir jautājumi? Jā, ir divus redzu vismaz. Jā, vispirms kungam un pēc tam dāmai pie kā galdiņa.
Labdien, vēlreiz. Gribēju uzdot tādu jautājumu, cik proporcionāli veiksme jūsu uzņēmumam ir atnesusi? Tas ir šis te papildu finansējums, jeb tomēr jūsu mārketings, ko jūs esat veikusi sabiedrībā. Paldies.
Well, that's a very good question, because some of the funding I received I used for marketing. As, for instance, the first funding, I was able to get an online marketing bureau. So it's not really the funding, and that's something that I wanted to tell you as well, you of the financial institution. I send in a plan, and I say, well, if the marketing goes better, I'm able to help more women. So it's not necessarily the one or the other, but so it helped me making myself and my brand more well known and making my business more sustainable. Is that an answer to your question, or didn't I understand it well? Well, as for you know, you wanted to know the division or the in percentages. It's about a third revenues, a third from the municipality, and a third from grants. That's basically how it's divided at this moment.
Super. Nākamais jautājums pie kā galdiņa bija, laikam.
Labdien, paldies par lekciju. Man tāds praktisks jautājums par tiem lietotajiem krekliem. Vai ir kaut kāda metoda arī, kā jūs apstrādājat to audumu, lai viņš tā kā izskatītos vēlāk kā jauns? Un vai iesniegtā krekla kvalitātei arī ir liela nozīme, vai arī viņš varbūt ļoti novalkāts vai arī nē? Nu, kaut kā tā tīri praktiski kāds notiek.
Yeah, that's a really a practical question indeed. Well, in fact, the fabric you send in is the one you get back at this moment. So that is, if it's really worn out in a way that, you know, once you have it on once and it would tear apart, we mail this customer and say, okay, we can do this for almost 30 euros, but it's not worth the money. You're not going to wear it. But most of the people send in really nice shirts. At the start, we washed every shirt that came in, but it turned out that you know, people send in clean shirts, and if they're not clean, I take them home and wash them then. But I thought it was not really sustainable to get clean shirts washed again. But so that's basically how we do it. And the fabric itself is, there's no extra thing that we do with it in order to make it work that way. Really, a shirt contains parts that are really good, that don't fade that much.
Mm-hmm. Super. Ir vēl kāds jautājums? Jā, pie E-galdiņa un C-galdiņa. Super.
Jā, paldies par iedvesmojošo lekciju. Ļoti nestandarta ideja, kas man patīk personīgi, bet tāds jautājums ir, vai nesanāk tā, ka nedaudz arī konkurēt, jo, piemēram, ja es nododu kreklu labdarībai, nu, otrreiz lietošanai, kādam tas varētu noderēt, kā jūs konkurēt tieši ar to aspektu, kad, nu, cilvēks tomēr izvēlās sūtīt jums un pārstrādāt šortos?
Yes, I think you're right. You can put it in a container. I don't know if in Latvia that's the same thing. Yes, you can put it in a container, which sometimes go to charity. That is really big business, by the way. I've learned a lot about it, and it's not that clean business for everyone. It's sometimes really a sort of income, extra income for municipality or government. So. And then, you know, you give it away, that's fine with me if you want to do that. I'm not, it doesn't feel like I'm competing because it's a sort of conscious choice of a customer who wants to upcycle its shirt, because if you throw it into a container, it will be either reused or it will be just, what's it called, it gets into fibers and all that. But it's not all that sustainable. I think what we do is much more directly sustainable, but you pay for it. So if I wanted to compete, I think I'm a very bad competitor because it's free to put it in a container and it's about 30 euros to get it into a Van Hulley.
Mm-hmm. Bija vēl jautājums pie C galdiņa un pēc tam vēl L galdiņš.
Skaidrs, ka ja runā par drēbēm, tad es nevarēju neķerties pie mikrofona, bet citiem arī bija iespēja. Mans jautājums pēc mega paldies par tiešām fantastisko, iedvesmojošo, aizkustinošu stāstu ir par to, ko jūs teicāt, kāpēc jūs šo darat, kā jums jūsu personības labākās izpausmes, jūsu pieredzes labākais zelts ir iespējams šajā te stāstā. Un, mums ir, acīm redzot, līdzīgi tā noslietas komunikāciju, un man kaut kas pašai par sevi kļuva skaidrs caur jūsu stāstu, un uzreiz radās jautājums, vai, piemēram, jūs līdz šim esat jau gājusi, varbūt domājat iet pie tiem citiem, piemēram, komunikācijas studentiem, kuri bieži vien domā, ka viņu nākamais solis droši vien būs pārdot citu cilvēku idejas, nevis pašiem pārdot savējās, nu, izdomāt produktu vai pakalpojumu, kur tikai tāpēc, ka tu esi pats autors, tikai tu pats arī vislabāk vari pārdot, kā jūs to šodien mums nodemonstrējāt.
Yeah, so if I understand correctly, you think why don't I inspire students to be more entrepreneurial instead of going somewhere else, or did not understand it well.
My question is, are you going around telling communication students that instead of being PR?
Oh, yes. Yes. it's true, and there's a lot of money made just through communication alone and not attached to a product or not. And but I do see a tendency within the students, within universities, that the entrepreneurial part is much more emphasized, even within a bigger company or corporates. The younger generation is much more inclined to take their fate in their own hands, and that's something that is really powerful and hopeful. I talk to recruiters and they say the generation that now leaves the university are much more looking for a job that has purpose, more than a job that pays well and that gets you a contract until you're 65 and a big car. Things are really changing. I think it's very hopeful, especially in these times where you know, with the politics that is not that positive. I strongly believe that the younger generation, because they are not that materialistic as 10, 20 years ago, they don't have all the opportunities that that generation had. They have to fight for themselves, and that gives them sort of, we call it a registration of your own fate. You know, you're more self-conscious by that. And so I do a lot of talks also to students, but then again, I have to also spend time in my company and try to push-up sales. But it's true, and it's very inspiring to do these talks. I can see that students get the message. Yeah.
Ok, un pēdējais jautājums pie L galdiņa bija, vai vēl bija kāds tāds degošs jautājums, vēl H galdiņš, ja? H. Un tad gan pieliksim punktu uz kādu brīdi, lai jums ir arī iespēja pašiem parunāt.
Labdien, Egils Rupeks, Svētā Lūkas atbalsta biedrība. Paldies par stāstu. Jautājums ir par challenge'iem. Bija minēti divi, viens no tiem ilgtermiņa biznesa modelis. Vai jau ir kāds redzējums par ilgtermiņa biznesa modeli? Paldies.
Yeah, the long-term business model of Van Hulley I was referring to was the shift towards not making only the one-on-one boxer shop, but making it a brand where I can do a sort of mass production, still in a factory that is helping people with a distance to the labor market. But in order to survive and to be more self-supporting, I need to get more volume. And the way we're working now is socially very successful, but not in terms of, you know, I would be dependent forever, more or less. And I had a sort of extreme choice between becoming a sort of model for reintegration agencies all over the Netherlands, either that or going more for the mass production where people can buy boxer shorts made from fabric that is already there. And I think that's a much more long-term sustainable plan, keeping the one that we're doing now. So it's not losing one thing, but it's more future-proof, I think. And we're using that, what we did very well in the last 4 years, using our brand knowledge and our communication skills and the way the values that we added to the brand in terms of sustainability and social and brand awareness, we use that and in order to build the brand much bigger. So that was my challenge for the long-term business model. Yeah. But it has organically grown. That's something that I also say to students. I would like to say to you too. I mean, you do have to calculate your risks, of course, but do start. I mean, you know, what can go wrong? Even if Van Hulley tomorrow would, you know, fall down, I would not regret one second of starting this business. It has brought me so much. And that's something else that I really want to emphasize with you. Don't hesitate to start. You never get 100% security on whether you would lose money or energy, but it's really worth the try because, you know, it's such a rewarding thing to do something for society and try to get something on the market. It's really nice.
Okay, un mums pēdējais jautājums bija.
Paldies, es pilnīgi jums arī piekrītu, es esmu Ligita Drūnu, nu, jāsaka, pēdējos daudz gadus tieši iedvesmoju šādām visām idejām arī jauniešus, bet tiešām arī mūsu jaunieši mainās un viņi tiešām izstrādā gan mācību idejas, kā veidot, pielāgot šo lietoto, jo vienreiz jau izmanto to materiālu un tiešām daudz visās idejas un bija līdz biznesa plānam, pat, kad veido savu zīmolu Žagata Ligzda, jo viņai tiešām bija uzvārts meitenē Žagata un tā Ligzda tiešām būtu ar tādu veselu modas kolekciju, ko varētu pārstrādāt. Un, bet man jautājums tiešām ir no tā uzņēmē darbības puses, ja nebūtu jums šo atbalstu papildus, vai tas varētu būt biznes, ja cik ir tā daļa, kad jūs sakat, jūs varat tieši arī nopelnīt, patstāvēt, un kāda tad īsti motivācija ir pircējiem, nu, cik viņi gatavi maksāt, vai šāda ideja tiešām varētu pastāvēt arī valstīs, kur šie vidēji ienākumi nav tik augsts kā jūsu zemē. Paldies!
That's a good question. You know, that's exactly what I was pointing at, that, you know, do start, because if I hadn't started, I wouldn't have encountered these grants. I wouldn't have encountered these foundations that realize that they are a vital aspect of starting social enterprises, because some of the foundations in Holland are really, you know, they know that starting a social enterprise is hard. It takes a lot of time from the entrepreneur him or herself, but also you need money. And some of these foundations are really specialized in it, and they do a wonderful job. They give grants because they believe that in the end it will be a sustainable business. So your question is a very good one, in the sense that if I wouldn't have had these grants, would I have been able to survive? I don't know. I don't think so. But maybe something else would have come around, and that's basically what I was trying to say. You know, please start, because if your idea is good, then money is not the problem. I'm convinced that even in countries where the money is maybe a bit is not successful, there's international funds available as well. As far as the selling price is concerned, I agree that it's a top level thing that you do. I'm not available for everyone, of course. To start with, for the women that make the boxer shorts, they would never buy something like that. But it's a fair price, and we are shifting towards a more consciousness and awareness on what really the price is compared to an H&M boxer short, for instance. So this is a sort of mission that I have to go for. If I wouldn't believe in it, then I wouldn't have a business case. For the mass production thing from the factory that I was telling you about, the price would be lower. So also the model would be a bit more simple, but still it would be a social and a sustainable boxer short. But I agree, it's not available for everyone.
Nu ko, aplausi mūsu runātājai, Jelenai.